This may come as some surprise, but I'm into you. I can see through all of your lies, but still I miss you.
Hey, Coco.
Surely you want it back.
Well, y'all and you guys are all mixing. Well, I know I haven't been live in a little hot minute for me, because usually I go live, you know, more often than I have. But I've been slowly backing away, believe it or not. That's why I just, I don't know. I'm kind of bored. I'm just kind of bored. And at first it was very exciting and something to look forward to, you know, and, you know, but nowadays it's a bore, you know, it's the same thing, the same people at it, you know, the same people, you know, mentioning you and, wanting you to respond back and, you know, to help keep their name going. And it's just the same thing, you know. And in my real fucking life, no bullshit, I would never, ever be with these people. I would never go anywhere near them. I would grab my purse, like close to me. If I ever saw them coming my way, I would never visit their homes. I would never allow, if I would see them walking in my neighborhood, I would lock the doors. I would be mad if they moved next door to me, because I would figure, I would really think that the value has went down of all I worked for my entire life. I'm over it. It's no other. I have my little circle, and I'm glad that I've met, you know, the people that I adore here on YouTube. And that's just about it. I try to make myself listen yesterday. And I was just like, because it's just the same stuff. Over and over and over. The scripts are running dry. Because people are not engaging anymore, it's become a bore. You get what I'm saying? People are showing themselves. So at first it was kind of like, okay, well, I'm going to, you know, I know somebody hasn't yet revealed themselves, so I'll just, you know, wait around. But pretty much everybody pretty much showed themselves, and so now it's just like, do I be in some bushes? Yeah. And so I like that song, as a matter of fact, by Chrisette. But maybe I did have an epiphany. But yeah, I'm over it. I don't know any better words to put it. When my channel got flagged, my backup, I was like, you know what? It's just amazing to me, like, how every fucking video done on me is still up. I don't flag. And then once I said, you know what? I'm gonna try this flagging shit. Since people flagging me, and it didn't work out so good, and I wasn't about to sit there and go to flag school, but yeah, it's never a fair game. I've been ganged up on, and secret alliances. It's just, it's not fun. It's not fun. The people that I don't want to be bothered with and have asked, you know, just go away. They just won't. And it's like, it's not like I just don't like you here. I don't like you in real life. Like, I can't stand you. I hate you. And it's bad when you, the first time you experienced hate is when you came to this environment. And so the people that I want to play with, like, you know, it's fun. It's fun to play with and to joke around with certain people on here. But the ones that I don't like, they won't stop. And now it's just like, oh my God. So because in my real life, I would never go anywhere near like these people, no matter how they think I look, or, you know, it just doesn't matter. I just don't want, I would never want you anywhere near me. I wouldn't sit by you in a concert. I wouldn't sit with you at a game. I wouldn't go with you to a club or a cruise. I wouldn't go with you anywhere. I would be too embarrassing, like embarrassed. Your shoes are stupid. Your outfits are corny. Like, you know what I'm saying? That's how I feel about these people who don't like me, and they won't go, like, leave me alone. And I do my best to try to stay as irrelevant as I possibly can. You would think that the low chat number would do it. No, it doesn't. They just keep going. You would think that doing content would do it. No, it just doesn't go away. They just continue, these people, to mention me in their live streams. And it's just like a sick obsession, and it's weird. And I'm over it. So I figured, I had to say to myself, self, then I said, huh? I said, why do you talk back to them? Why do you, if you wouldn't talk to them in real life or want them anywhere near you, why are you responding here? And I said to myself, I said, self, and then I said, huh? I said, you make a great point. Why am I talking to you back? See, like, even in real life, when bums ask for like a dollar or something, like a coffee or something, you give it to them, but you don't expect for them to like follow you home. You don't expect for them to ask you, where are you going? Or can I see those glasses in your glasses case? Anything other than when they ask for prayer or a dollar, you give it to them. And then you go away. If you catch that bum sitting out in front of your door, it's like, why are you here? Who, first of all, let you through the gate? And then if you got through the gate, if you jumped it, yeah. Why, what are you doing? If that bum decides to stand outside my gate every day, screaming and hollering my name from that one buck exchange, then it's just like, oh, little buddy. So I'm just bored with it. I am. These people homes, I would never, even if I'm from that city, I would never go to your area. It's below me. It's dirty. It's trashy. It stinks. It's full of druggies. It's why are you live where? I don't understand. Why are you talking to me? Why? I can see if people was humble with their living conditions. See, when I saw Misunderstood's post today, it has to be assumed when it comes to me, and I get it. I understand. And guess what? Some people, living conditions and accounts are better than mine and larger than mine, but I don't go around treating them as if I'm better than them. That's like backwards. So that's just the point. I'm over it. I'm over it. I know it's a couple months break, so I'm just trying to lay down a little bit of content, you know, and whenever I feel like it, then that's when I'll do it, period. I have my family here and have my environment that I want, and I just want to be left alone and be in my corner. And people who like me, I like them back. People who want to love on me, I'll love on them back. People who want to, you know, show love and support to my channel, I'll show love and support to their channel. It's just as simple as that. You know what I'm saying? All right. So let's get into Confessions of a Video Vixen. This is sponsored by our lovely China White. She wanted to read this book. And so I went on and got it. And so we're going to begin with chapter one. It's very long, the chapter. So I don't know if I'm going to get to two. I'm watching a new series on Netflix, and I'm going to get back to that. You know, Netflix is, you know, the thing, I guess. It's always been a thing, but, you know, now I'm all like engaged. All right. So chapter one is called Death and Lie. Death and Life. Okay. October 2001, I was lying on the hard, cold floor in the bathroom of the famous Chinese bistro, Mr. Chow, in Beverly Hills. It is one of the most upscale and re-owned restaurants in the world. Yet I was at the lowest point of my life, with my head next to the toilet. I was alone, in debt, with no friends and no hope. Renowned. Oh my God. Anyway, it had been a long, hard trip that led to this fall. It was a wild roller coaster ride, which included some of the hottest names in hip hop in Hollywood. For 2 years, I rode it out. I was in the middle of it all, dining with P. Diddy, partying with Vin Diesel, going one-on-one with Shaquille O'Neal. I had money, 3 cars, a condo, in a prestigious. Guys, please excuse my speech impediment, and I'm retarded, okay? Neighborhood, a nanny for my son. I had starred in some of the hottest music videos with Jay-Z, LL, Cool J, Ja Rule, and Ludacris. I had even co-starred in the blockbuster film, A Man Apart, opposite Vin Diesel. And just to stop right there, I forgot for a hot minute that, okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I forgot that she was in a relationship heavy with Vin Diesel. I don't know if you remember, China. Coco, I don't know if you read this book before, but yeah, I remember reading that she was, I believe they were in like a strong secret relationship with each other, like love. Okay. But here I lay on a cold bathroom floor, hugging the toilet's frigid porcelain, completely hopeless. I was broke, homeless, and probably dying. The last thing I remembered was my body shaking violently as I sat on the toilet with my head in my hands and my friend Eva hovering over me, asking me if I was okay. But now I was on the floor and she was gone. Can I move? Was the only thought swirling through my head. Hold on. I gotta turn the page. I tried to say something to make sure I was alive. I couldn't. I tried to move my leg, and it worked. I stood up and made my way to the sink. I looked around the small one-stall bathroom. It was dimly lit and tiny, yet elegant. I held on to the sink, looking at myself in the mirror. My pupils were fully dilated, and I could feel my knees wobbling beneath me. I splashed cold water on my face, hoping to snap out of the trouble I was so obviously in. I looked at my jewelry and clothes. I still wore the diamond heart pendant and the canary yellow diamond earrings that my ex-husband had given me years before. My ring and bracelet were gifts purchased at Tiffany. My long nails were perfectly French manicured, and my hair was long and black. My skin had been tanned by the Miami sun, and my eyes were gray thanks to my colored contacts. My face was made up to perfection, compliments of MAC and Chanel. My jeans were a $200 pair by fashion icon Marc Jacobs, and the rest of the assemble followed suit. Everything was designer made, from my jewelry to my makeup to the clothes I wore, even the drugs I'd consumed. The next thing I knew, I was on the floor again. When I came to from another bout of convulsions, my tongue was swollen and bloody. I crawled up from the floor and made my way back to the sink to splash more water on my face. I desperately wanted someone to walk in and help, but no one came. I began to panic with the thoughts of the late actor, River Phoenix, racing through my head. Thoughts of him seizing outside of the Viper Room, not too far from where I was on Sunset Boulevard, right before dying. I thought of how awful it would be if I died in the bathroom at Mr. Chow. I thought of the irony of it all, of the paparazzi waiting outside for Nicolas Cage and LL Cool J, who were both in the dining area eating with friends. I thought of how pretty and rich I looked, yet my life had become ugly and poor. But the most prominent thought was of my son, Naeem. My nanny hadn't heard from me in months, and had no idea how to find me. No one even knew my real name or where I lived or who my family was or where I came from. To them, my name was Yazette, a name that I had made up when I was 16, during my years as a stripper. I thought of Naeem and wanted to live. I thought if I screamed his name as loud as I could, God would hear me and allow me another chance at being a mother. God had to know that despite everything I had done until this point, I loved my son and wanted to do right by him. I stumbled to the bathroom door, opened it, and began to scream his name into the stairwell that led downstairs into the main dining area of the restaurant. I screamed his name over and over until my voice was gone. No one heard me. I stumbled back into the restroom to splash more water on my face, hoping the water alone would be enough to reverse what I had done. My heart was racing, and its beat was all I could hear in my head. There were sweat beads on my face. My mouth was dry, and my vision blurred. My body went into convulsions 3-4 more times, each time landing me on the cold, hard towel. No one was there for me. I was going to die alone. 1 year earlier, no one could have told me that life would turn out that way. I was invited to a function one Friday night in October 2000 at the Sky Bar located on Sunset Strip. I reluctantly met an acquaintance there and quickly began to mingle in order to make the best out of what promised to be a boring evening. The crowd was very stuffy, and I found myself yawning in between conversations with a concert pianist and a score composer. After about an hour of walking around, sampling the vast array of mediocre hors d'oeuvres, I'm tongue-tied, and I have a speech impediment. But you know what I'm talking about. In oversized apple martinis, I was ready to go as I searched for the acquaintance who'd brought me to the event. He came up behind me, grabbed my arm, and pulled me towards him. "I want you to meet someone," he said. "Gary, this is Yazette. Yazette, this is Gary." As I said before, Yazette was a name and a persona I made up when I was 16, after I ran away from my father and wanted a new identity and hopefully a new life. I landed in Los Angeles. Gary was handsome, dressed all in black, and of medium build and height. He was soft-spoken and reserved. As we began to talk, we realized that we shared the same sentiments about the function we were attending. We laughed at each other's silly jokes and soon found ourselves exchanging phone numbers. After the functions, we all headed over to a local club called Nora's Cafe. There we continued to sip martinis. And at one point, I am sure I climbed on top of a table and started dancing. It was a night to remember, but by the following morning, I had forgotten most of it. The next afternoon, when I had finally recovered from the night before, I checked my messages to find one from Gary. Initially, I can't remember who Gary was among the sea of people I had met at the Sky Bar and at Norris Cafe. After a brief moment of recollection, I began to connect the voice with the face. I failed, however, to return the call. That Sunday, while I was driving around in West Los Angeles, my cell phone rang. The number was unfamiliar to me, so I answered with caution. "Hey, Yazette, this is Gary from the other night," the voice said. I rolled my eyes in silent response. I was used to men hitting on me and thought that Gary was just another example, but I was wrong. What Gary said next would not only surprise me, it would change my life. He began to explain to me that he was a film director and he was in the beginning stages of production on his new film. He wanted me to pick up a copy of the script and read for him. He said there was a part he thought would be perfect for me. I was unsure what to think and actually doubted that he was a director of any substance. After you lived in Los Angeles for a while, you begin to take what people say they do with a grain of salt, particularly in Hollywood. Still, that Monday, I went to the address he gave me on Beverly Boulevard. I arrived at the production office and picked up the script. Once in my car, I began to read it and was baffled because the character I was to be reading for, Candace Hicks, appeared nowhere in the script. The very next day, I was called to read on camera for Gary and the producers. I read lines for another character while trying to conceal my nervous stomach and dry mouth. Just as with many other things, I performed without thought. I read the lines through a few times, and that was it. I was done. Gary walked me out to the hallway and thanked me for coming by. I was still unsure of what I had just done, what it was for, or who I was dealing with. But I began to get a clue once he mentioned that I was up for the role of the wife of Lorenz Tate's character. Lorenz Tate was a name I knew from his previous movies, so the project became a bit more legitimate and real. Had I known how big this opportunity really was, I might not have gotten through the audition. On the Thursday after we met, I received a call from Gary's production office telling me I had been cast as Candace Hicks, the wife of Demetrius Hicks, played by Lorenz Tate. They said the part would have to be written for me. I was thrilled. Although I had acted all throughout my school years, and being in films was something I had always dreamed of, it was never something that I felt was an achievable goal. But here it was. After I digested everything Gary's crew told me, it finally hit me. Gary was famed director F. Gary Gary, who had done Set It Off, Friday, and The Negotiator, and would go on to direct The Italian Job and Be Cool. I was going to be part of a big budget New Line Cinema production. When I left my sad life and ran to Los Angeles, I had no idea what I would be doing. I had no idea how I was going to survive. For me, being part of a film was much more than surviving. It was a move toward succeeding. On the following Monday, just a week and a half after meeting Gary, I showed up for my first table reading with the entire cast. Gary sat at the head of the table and Lorenz sat directly across from me. I didn't recognize many of the actors there, but was secretly drawn to a tall, muscular man sitting directly to my right. His voice was overwhelmingly powerful, yet his demeanor was gentle. From time to time, his shoulder brushed against mine, and I would get a rush. My attraction to this man was strong. His name was Vin Diesel. Coincidentally, my first film shoot would take place just a few blocks away from the house where I shot my very first music video. We began shooting A Man Apart at Zuma Beach in Malibu. I awakened at 3 a.m. and got in my car to drive to the set. I glided into Malibu by way of the well-known picturesque calm of the Pacific Coast Highway, with the windows in my car down so I could feel the air brisk and moist with dew. I was blasting my radio and sang along loudly with every song during 1 hour drive from my condo. I arrived on the set and headed directly to the catering truck for a breakfast burrito, then sat in the hair and makeup trailer. I was officially an actress. I felt that everything I had done up until that point, everything that had happened to me from my abusive childhood, the rape, being a teen or runaway, the stripping, had not stopped me or beaten me. I had reinvented myself. I was moving on and hopefully moving up. Perhaps when one has a difficult start in life, the universe has a way of balancing everything out. I do believe that every cloud has a rainbow and a silver lining. I had many, many clouds, more than most. So chapter 2 is next. I guess I'll just go ahead and get it over with, since I'm still under an hour. What do you guys think? Hey, BPR. Akoma! Oh my God, where have you been? Okay, guys, I'm going to just take like a quick break really quick. All right, and then I'm going to go into chapter 2.
It's over.
time sleep or faith. So I think we're just about over being your girlfriend. I'm leaving. Not wondering what you've been doing, where you've been sleeping. So I'm leaving. So I'm leaving. Yeah. So you walk in. The next morning, to find me smiling like nothing ever happened. And give me some excuse, like you always do. I just kiss your cheek, and this is what I tell you.
So on to chapter 2, the sins of the mother. I hate my mother. Those are strong words that are forbidden and shunned by God. And I struggle with this emotion every day of my life. But it's how I feel as a child while I would see other children long for their mothers, cling to their mothers, cry for their mothers. I was glad when my mother was away. I hated to be near mine. I hated to hear her voice and would feel nauseated in anticipating her return home from work. I cringed when she was in the same room with me and looked forward to bedtime because that meant, at least for the day, my time with her was over. I was fully aware of these feelings as early as 3 years old. It seems almost unnatural for a child to despise the woman who gave him or her life. But my life was different, and I knew I wasn't like other children. My mother is beautiful. She is one woman melting pot of Puerto Rican, Jamaican, and Danish heritage. I remember her skin as being slightly tanned and her hair thick and wavy. She walked with a switch and a sway, and everywhere she went, men followed. She bathed herself in perfume and wore tight-fitting clothes. She adorned herself with 24-karat gold. She was never without a man, somebody's man. But even with all of her beauty and charm, there was another side to Josephine. She was very unhappy and didn't have any female friends. She based her whole existence on the ability to get a man, and and she always seemed unhappy because one of these men who she so desperately needed in her life had done her wrong. There was a revolving door of men when I was growing up. Some of them even came back for seconds and thirds, but none of them ever stayed. I knew she loved my father and wanted to be with him, but he too didn't stay. His time with her seemed just to be that time. and time makes things change. I witnessed my mother running around town aimlessly. I wouldn't hear the woman around town talk about her. I'm so sorry. I would hear the women around town talk about her. It usually followed a complimentary comment about me. Karen, she's so smart. You know, she's the only one to score 100 on her last test. But that mother of hers, I heard she was seen with so-and-so husband. Eventually, my two sisters came along, born only a year and a half apart. We were all bastards, each of us the product of a different man. Men who would never stay, men who would never come back. Men who I was forced to call uncle, something for which I resented my mother. I never really knew the two men who fathered my sisters. To tell the truth, I don't believe my mother knew them very well either. She seemed to be in this vicious cycle of trying to keep men in her life by having their babies. After the third child, perhaps she began to get the hint. I remember vividly one night I woke up and was startled to realize that I had been removed from the bed and crammed into the crib with my infant sister. My mother was 5 months pregnant with my youngest sister. I immediately figured that my mother needed the bed. There was a back door in our room that led to the backyard. It was perfect for my mother, who had been sneaking men in and out of this door nearly her entire life. I couldn't make out of what was being said, but the tone of the whispers were heavy. Just as my vision had thoroughly adjusted, I realized the man standing in the doorway must have been the father of the baby she was carrying. I blinked a few times, wanting to get a better look, and tried to make out what was being said. My mother was begging, "No, don't go, don't go." Her hands were wrapped around his wrists, and the two of them were caught in a sort of tug of war. My mother lost the battle as he was rigged free and charged out the door. It looked like a scene out of Gone with the Wind, as my mother's rounded silhouette crouched to the door in agony, crying. I was almost 8 years old, and I can remember not feeling at all sorry for her. In fact, I was a little happy. She deserved to feel the same sort of pain she had inflicted upon those around her, including me. I was so embarrassed to be my mother's daughter. When I heard the woman talk about her at school and in the streets, I hung my head in shame. And as much as I hated my mother, I believe she felt the same way about me. I was a reminder to her of everything she could not be. I was young and had my whole life ahead of me. I was smart, and the entire island where I grew up acknowledged me. I was my father's daughter, and around the island, even though he had long since left, people remembered him. He had owned a few businesses on the island and employed many people. My father was charismatic, and because he was from New York, he stood out on the tiny island. I would hear stories about how handsome and smart and witty he was. A woman once stopped us in the street and said I was a beautiful and that I looked just like him. As she walked away, my mother pulled me to the side and said, "She's lying. She's just saying that because she used to like your father." My mother always made me feel I was less than a person. She despised the fact that I received constant praise, and she was worthy of none. Before I was born, she was the center, and now I had taken her shine. We were in competition from the day I arrived. My purpose in life was supposed to be to keep my father with her, to make him love her. But a one-night stand is just that, no matter how long it lasts. the mistake he made wasn't leaving her, but leaving me with her. I was born in 1978 on a hot, sticky, late August day on the 28 square mile island of St. Thomas. My mother was an 18-year-old native. My father was 26 and lived on the island from 1976 to 1984. After my father went back to his life on Long Island, New York, my mother and I lived with my grandmother, Vivian, in her four-bedroom house. Along with me, my mother and grandmother were also my aunt, two cousins, and two uncles. Later came my two younger sisters. In all, there were 10 of us sharing four bedrooms. The house had one bathroom, uncovered windows, no hot water, no washing machines, and no air conditioning. On most days, we had to boil water for our baths. On those days, my two cousins and I shared the same bath water. The rule was the youngest bathed first, which was one of the few times being the youngest paid off for me. But sometimes there was no time to boil water, and that's when we took cold showers and took them very quickly. My grandmother would wash all of the clothes by hand, everything, towels and sheets, jeans, shirts. Everyone was supposed to wash their own clothes, but my grandmother could often be seen outside with two large barrels washing everyone's clothes. Then they would be hung out to dry on the wire lines she had tied between two poles in the backyard. The bathroom was small and run down, as was most of the house. The water supply was prepaid and delivered to the house by a water truck, which funneled the water into the cistern below the house. Because of this, we weren't allowed to use much water. So we kept empty buckets outside to save rainwater and even saved bath water in order to flush the toilet. My grandmother saw no sense in flushing the clean water that could be used for drinking. Come winter, spring, or fall, sunshine. Or hurricane, the windows to our house always seemed to be open. They were actually louvers, metal shutters, with a turning handle which would open them. There was no glass or screens to protect the house from insects or even large animals. It was not unusual to come home to a bat or a tarantula, a stray cat, dog, or chicken in the house. It was common to just chase them into the backyard. The backyard was like another world filled with fruit trees like banana, papaya, guava, avocado, and passion fruit. Stray animals lived back there surrounded by a plethora of herbs. I can't believe I said herbs. It's herbs. Herbs that my grandmother would boil down to make home remedies for any and all ailments. This was the way life was there. It was normal. It was also normal for my grandmother to take care of us all. My mother would stay out all night, sometimes not returning for days at a time. But my grandmother, Vivian, was always there. I called her Ma. She encouraged me and she supported me. I was a smart kid, well known for my academic achievements. I was also featured in the school plays and showcases. When the Stouffer's Corporation built a resort on the island waterfront in 1983, I was invited to recite poems I had written and to cut the ribbon at the opening ceremony. My grandmother was there. My mother was not. My mother never came to any of my events. It was my grandmother who made sure that every time I performed, I had shiny new patent leather shoes and a brand new dress. She was adamant that no one ever saw me in the same dress twice. My grandmother was strict, but it was evident that she loved me. The relationship between my grandmother and my mother was quite a different story. There was something there, and I was never sure what it was. My grandmother, Vivian, had 7 children, some from different fathers. My mother was the youngest and the sibling with the fairest complexion, something that was obviously an issue among the sisters. I believe that my mother, Father Axel, was the only man who had married my grandmother. And my mother played that card as often as possible. In her mind, being light-skinned and the only non-bastard of the 7 made her superior to the others. If my grandmother did show any favor at all, it may have been only because my mother was the baby, the last born of 7 children. It is my belief that it was the favor my mother was shown outside of the house, which made her feel superior. And in return, my aunts resented her. By the time I was born, the damage between my aunts and my mother had been done. Even as a young child, I could feel the tension. To this day, none of my aunts speak to my mother, and neither does my grandmother. As I got older, it seemed like my relationship with my mother grew more and more contentious. You know what I'm saying. She became more impatient and more brutal toward me. One day after school, right after my first sister was born, I went to meet my mother at her job at a little clothing store called Marianne's. As I was leaving to walk home, I noticed a woman in a car parked outside next to the sidewalk. She called me over and asked if my mother had a baby boy or a girl. Being 7, I answered the question truthfully, a girl, and continued on my way home. Not even 30 minutes after I got into the house, my mother came barreling through the door. A sinking feeling came over me. Automatically, I knew I was in trouble. I wasn't sure what I had done, but I knew for sure that I was in trouble. "You are not to tell my business out in the street," my mother yelled at me. "I don't care who asks you what. You are to keep your mouth shut." No one was at home, and I prayed silently that my grandmother would make it through the door before the first blow of the belt. My mother walked away and came back with a Webster's World Edition dictionary. It was the biggest book I have ever seen as a child. It contained every single word in the English language and many from other parts of the world, including slang. This book must have weighed more than 10 pounds. And as she picked it up, I just knew she was going to swing it across my head. I closed my eyes and I kept praying for my grandmother to make it home from work. As I prayed, my mother was still going on about what I had done wrong. It was all too grown up for me to really understand. I didn't know the rules of engagement between adults. At 7 years old, I had no idea what business was and why other women were in hers. And for this, I was about to get hit by the Webster. I felt this heavy weight on top of my head and opened my eyes to see that my mother had placed the dictionary on my head. "Get on your knees and balance this until I come back," she barked. "And you better not move or take this book from your head." And then she was gone. I figured she left to undo any damage I had done by telling her business. So I knelt there, still praying. My young, rational mind told me to get up from that spot and relax my aching back and knees. And if she did make it back, I had enough time to put the dictionary back on my head and get back into position before she hit the door. It was a brilliant plan, and I could have most certainly worked, but my frightened true self had serious doubts. What if I don't make it back into position in time? I asked myself. She'll tear me into shreds, and no one will be here to save me. This was the least violent punishment I have ever had, and I was not going to mess it up. This was a good thing, I told myself. I stayed there on my knees with the book on my head, crying and praying for 2 hours. I was weak. My neck, back, and knees felt like they were breaking with each passing minute. And just as I ran out of tears, my grandmother came through the front door to see me there in the kitchen, struggling to maintain my punishment. "What the hell?" she screamed in anguish. I immediately began to ramble off the events which had led to this scene. As I relieved the moments, the tears began to stream again. The look in my grandmother's eyes was so painful. She didn't understand the story and how I could be punished for answering a question honestly, for essentially being a child. The hurt in her eyes made me hurt more, and I began to cry less for myself and more for her. It wouldn't be the last time she'd be there to rescue me. My grandmother had been a seamstress. I loved making clothes for my dolls out of her leftover scraps of material. One day, though, I had a better idea, and my drawer was a sock without a meat, white with a lacy ruffle around the edge. My creative brain went to work as I cut the toe from the sock and made a pair of shoulder straps, creating a frilly ball gown for my doll. Somewhere in the middle of all the excitement, I lost my mother's shears. I hadn't noticed until she came home from work and started looking for them. She finally asked me, "Have you seen my scissors? They are not in my sewing box where I left them." By the look of sheer terror in my eyes, she could tell that I had done something wrong. So I confessed to making the sock dress. She looked high and I looked low. The scissors were lost and I couldn't breathe or swallow because my next move could be the end. Just as I had given up on ever finding the orange handled scissors, I spotted them behind the bed. Why hadn't I seen them there before? Just as I began to feel relieved that the scissors had been found, I was attacked from behind with a 6-inch wide leather belt. My mother beat me and beat me until my body was on fire. Every lash felt like 1,000. As she beat me, she spewed obscenities and told me how stupid I was. The lashes got more and more severe until the welts opened up and began to ooze blood. She had stripped me naked and beaten me until my body lay swollen and bloody. I was fading in and out of consciousness. The next thing I remember is my grandmother bursting through the bedroom door, grabbing me by the wrist, throwing me into the shower, and running cold water over my blistering skin. On any other day, I dreaded a cold shower, but on that day, I reveled in it. It felt as if the cold water brought me back to life. As I stood there in the tub, catching my breath, I could hear my grandmother and my mother fighting. My grandmother, Vivian, was my guardian angel. My mother, to me, was the devil. And while the battle of good against evil played out in the next room, I was in my own personal purgatory in the bathroom. Soon enough, my purgatory would turn into a living hell. The four of us being crammed into this one bedroom must have taken a toll on my mother. It also seemed that my mother had finally had enough of living on a small island where everyone knew her business. When I was 10 years old, we packed up and moved to Florida. We arrived during one of the state's coldest winters, which seemed fitting. I didn't appreciate the change in venue because it took me away from the one person who who was always, you know, in my corner, my grandmother. I was in the fifth grade and became a social outcast. I wasn't as pretty as the other girls in my school. I had an accent from my years on the island, and I wasn't the academic standout I had been back in St. Thomas. This was a much bigger playing field. I was lost, and my mother didn't help. I remember my fifth grade banquet. It was the end of the school year, and I had gone through the entire semester looking and feeling like a misfit. My clothes were never up to date, and I wore the same things over and over. There was hope for me to redeem myself at the banquet because my mother would be making my dress. When she arrived home with a few yards of a peach satin material, I was pleased. I could hear myself in a beautiful feminine peach gown that everyone would adore and envy. I don't know if I said it wrong. Anywho, as my mother went to work on my dress, I waited and watched. I knew I couldn't tell anyone that my mother was making my dress. So when I was asked about it, I said that she had bought me a beautiful peach dress from the mall and that it was very expensive. 3 days after my mother had started the dress, it was finished. I raced home to see the finished product. There it was, hanging on the closet door in my room. It was peach, it was frilly, and it was horrible. It looked like a big satin box with sleeves and ruffles. I was mortified. Holding back the tears of disappointment, I tried the dress on as she instructed, and it fell over my tiny frame like a brown paper bag. I arrived at the schoolyard for the banquet with this peach drape hanging from my bony shoulders. I heard the laughter, but I pretended that I didn't. I felt small as I looked around the room at everyone else's dress. I wish I were invisible. As the day went on, I grew increasingly self-conscious and watched the clock, constantly waiting for the banquet to end. Finally, when my mother picked me up that afternoon, she spoke the words which would stay with me forever. Upon seeing all the other girls' dresses, she said, excuse me, "See, that's why I made you a dress. I don't want anybody looking at you." Now that we were far away from the island where I had family and friends who loved and supported me, she could make me look and feel so small, no one would notice me, and she did. However, by the end of my fifth grade year, someone did notice me. His name was Kevin. I don't remember much about him, except he had blonde hair and blue eyes, and I thought he was the cutest boy in my class. After school, I invited him and another boy, as well as one of my best friends, back with me to my house. There were only about 2 hours between the time. When I got home from school and the time when my mother returned home from work, but I began to find ways to maximize that little block of time. On one afternoon, Kevin gave me my first real kiss. I was 10. And a lot of things inside of me would be different from that point on. I would crave the feeling I had the day when he kissed me. I felt loved. I felt pretty. I was acknowledged, and I wanted more. All right, guys. she is fast. I haven't read this book in a very, 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 very long time. When it first hit, I read it So it has been, oh my God, I think we're going on about 20 years, almost 20 years, that this book was written. I appreciate telling the, you know, what happened in the beginning of her life. I mean, it's appropriate so we can get to know her. Sound like she had a rough childhood. Good Lord. It sounded like the mother didn't really like her at all. It's sad. And it's nuts because it is some women out here. Oh, my God. Thank you, child. Even with, listen, I'm learning to make my imperfections my perfections. Nah, I ain't learning that. You know, I don't give a fuck. But anywho, yeah, it sounds like her mother was like maybe, you know, jealous of her. And it's sad because it's really some parents out here that are like that towards their own daughters. And they treat them like crap. Okay, so it sounds like she purposely made that dress to be ugly so her daughter can get laughed and I can't imagine as a mother doing that. You know what I mean? But hey, it is some fucked up ass parents out here. You have parents out here nowadays that care where their child sleeps at night. Whether they eat, they put dick before their children, right? So reading this book is like, I wouldn't say the norm, not in my surroundings, but being here on YouTube, we've seen a lot of this, you know, women that are quick to, they put YouTube in front of their children. They put men, you know, leaving them home and, you know, or leaving a back door open, child boo. I can go on and on for days, but it's unfortunate, you know, and it's crazy because in the beginning of the book, she left, you know, excuse me, her son, Naeem, because it kind of like started at the present, which she was going through. And then we just like backed up to her childhood. You know, she left her son with a nanny. You know, if you were paying attention, she hasn't seen him. I can't imagine. You know what I mean? I have went off with my husband, I would say about 2 days tops, and I couldn't take it. I can't stay away from my kids for too long. I can't. And I'm being 100% honest with you. And so a lot of times as parents, as mom, as mothers, we can feel like overwhelmed. And so when we do get that getaway, it's like, oh, you know, but man, after that second day, I'm like, I'm over it. I like literally told my husband, like, I want to go home. Just like that. I want to go home. Mm-hmm. And I don't go too far from them. I have to literally be, you know, just a couple hours of plane ride the most. But guys, I'm not going to lie to you. Like the last time I did a getaway for myself. I, and this is like right hand on the Bible, like all my life. I went around a corner. I did to a Marriott. I did. And, but I was right around the corner. And, I didn't feel like being bothered with anybody. I just wanted some time to myself, because I get like that. Like I'm I wouldn't say withdrawn, it's just that like once I complete mommy's task and wifey task and do all of that stuff, then I like immediately go into like isolation. I do. And sometimes you can't help it because you know kids run back and forth and stuff like that. But but that's to be expected. Of course, and you're used to it, but you know, you appreciate that too because they want to check on mommy. But my getaway, the last getaway for me, I went to a hotel, like I did. I went to a Marriott around the corner. And I just, and it's so weird because, and this is true. You think I'm weird, but, you know, it's a bar and, you know, Marriott, especially in Miami, come on. And so I wanted a drink and I'm not very trusting. And so I would call my husband and I told him. I told him to, I'm not very trusting. I don't, I'm not very social. I'm social, but just like sitting at a bar, oh no. So it's like creeps. I didn't want nobody to talk. Like everybody's friendly at the bar because everybody's tipsy, you know? So people talk to you and stuff like that. And I was just like, mm-mm. So I called him and yeah, we sat at the bar. We had a few drinks. I was like, all right, see you. See you later. For real. Mm-hmm. Walked me to my door. And I was in the bed watching Lifetime. You got me fucked up. Yeah, you need it. You know what I mean? But being away from my kids, like what? The moment I woke up in the morning, it was like, shit. Okay, gotta get this done. Gotta get this done. What's that classical song? That's my head all day long. You get what I'm saying? So I just immediately, you know, checked out, went home, and there go. You know what I'm saying? And you back to duties again. Who the fuck stays away from their kids and stays away from their, I don't understand that. I'll never get that. You know, you probably didn't just hear just now. It was not pitter-patter. They are just, you know, just my husband peeking in. Like, it's norm. But anyway, we're not peeking in because I'm in trouble or anything. Just peeking in just to make sure I'm okay. So I do that to my own children. So anyway, we're gonna continue on with 3 and 4 because we are behind. I remember when on the other channel, I got a little distracted from doing my content. And like I said, I do. I'm not gonna lie to you. I do have a break coming up. And this break, it's going to be taken very seriously. No responding because I'm not doing that now. So I don't care who says my name. I don't care about any of that. I'm so over these people. I really am. I know you guys have said it multiple times, but as of late, I don't think you know how over it that I am. I'm really, really over it. Okay. So we're going to pick up 3 and 4 tomorrow. I don't know what time, and I don't want to promise either because I'm really funny acting. So even though I get my little cash apps and stuff, thanks to everybody who donated too. Like, y'all looked out for the cookout. And I appreciate that. That's what's up. So I'm going to get into chapter 3 and 4 tomorrow. Okay. It was good seeing some of y'all. I'm sorry I haven't been up to hold on, guys. Okay, sorry about that, guys. All right, so I know I haven't been really into like the Yollywood thing and all of that stuff. And I know that's a part of my content. Maybe I'll feel like it, you know, acting up maybe someday. But I really do want to just get, y'all don't understand. I really, really like just doing content and being in my corner. And, you know, I've been there and done that. You know what I mean? Regardless of the fact, I'm still going to get contributions because my supporters rock with me like that. But I do have to understand, too, that I do have supporters that like the fuck shit and do like to, you know, catch up on certain things. I am, however, going to do a show. I'm not going to tell you guys what on, but we got some catching up to do. It's been a lot of mess I haven't been tuned in for all of it. I'm not going to lie to you. My sisters are more in the mix than I am. So they know what's going on. So they can, hopefully, when I do Yollywood News, we can have Coco. Right? We can have Coco co-host. So you can put me on to what's going on. Because I'm right hand up the guy. I'm not even joking. I have no clue as to everything that's going on. It's only about two stories that I'm keeping up with. That's it. But other than that, I'm over it. And I'm just disgusted. I'm disgusted too with myself. And the reason being is because when I came back, I specifically said that I just wanted to just be in my corner, in my zone. But I believe that things have to happen so you can eliminate all the people that are not for you, that are around you, because that brings bad fucking energy. You get what I'm saying? I'm very sensitive to certain energies. And during this sensitive time, for especially when I first came back, August 2021, I came back. And I was very, very spiritually sensitive during that time. And I didn't want to be around certain negativity and stuff like that, being still, I'm coming back from a spiritual awakening. So I'm sensitive at that moment. So now, I'm still sensitive, but I stopped protecting my peace. And so when you stop protecting your peace, I don't have the same reaction as I had before. Before, I wouldn't mind. Like, what you mean? Like, I would shut shit down. The fuck? Snap the fuck out. You know what I mean? Like, I would be on some crazy nut shit. I did, slipped into diva mode. I did say, yeah, I'm about to become a full-blown demon. But I'm not as bad as I used to be. You hear me? Because on some real shit, like, I almost literally, I would say about last month, I said, I really was at fuck this. And, I was just going, just not. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't understand. Like, if y'all don't get how I am, like, I was going to just do one last, you know what I'm saying? But see, I had to get myself together because motherfuckers, this is why they sit on here and do the things that they do, because some of them are trying to get you like caught up. You see what I'm saying? They're jealous of your life and what you have accomplished. They've accomplished nothing. So if they're quick to pick up the phone, call 911 on here, what do the fuck you think they'll do? You show up. So like, I'm that, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I had to pop my collar just even, you know what I'm saying? Because I will set it the fuck off. And but anyway, so I'm really disappointed in myself for even falling into what the traps that were set, because as soon as I got back, it was just like nonstop mentioning me, nonstop. And I would ignore it until one day I just snapped the fuck out. What happened as soon as I snapped the fuck out? When I snapped the fuck out, they start responding saying, look, she's doing this for this. So it's a never-ending story. She's doing this for content. She's picking with me. She's a troublemaker. She's a bully. Do you get what I'm saying? How the fuck am I a bully? I came back and I was doing content, ignoring. So it's that, this is what they do. So regardless of whether you respond or don't, they're always going to still have something to say. Just like I still haven't responded back to a burnt toast face talking about me on her community wall. Why are you're like 2 weeks late? But see, people, those type of miserable people, they don't like peace. So when a person is too at peace, this is why they start back up again, because they want you to get upset. And I think this past, I would say, week, I should have been disciplined, self-disciplined already, which I think that I did fairly well. considering the storm that I could brew. But anyway, I'm just done. It's just the same story over and over. Majority of these women are so jealous hearted, and then they're jealous hearted about things I can't control. I can't control how God made me. That's for one. I can't control who supports me. I can't control who likes me. I can't control who cares about me. I can't control any of that. And you have these bitter bitches. That's what they are. Bitter bitches. They have accomplished nothing in their life. Nothing. But they want to try to convince you that you're nothing. And I can't do it anymore. Hey, auntie, I really can't. I can't. So I don't know when, you know, my little break is going to come. I just want to make sure that I have something to leave for my supporters, you know, on you guys' downtime, you know, including fun lives too. You know, I'm just not feeling it these days. Nobody runs me nowhere. Each break that I took or each time I fell back, it was because, you know, I did. I wanted to fall back, but just right now, my face twisted up. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm on some cocky shit, on some real shit. Like, bitch, you know what I'm saying? So that's where I'm at with it. Thank you for emailing me. Those who do, let me know. People, you know, I don't care. My name is going to be mentioned. It's because I'm the shit. I'm diva. I'm diva tomboy. And that's just what it is. Regardless of who's in my chat, who's not, the fact is, I am a main character. And, you know, whether people want to face it or not, not saying that things will end if I ever left. No, it will just be a main character missing, which is like, you know, the motherfuckers who flags my channel. I think that's what did it for me. The flagging, because I just don't get that. I can't stand pussies. I really can't. You see what I'm saying? Like, I want a box. You know, nobody want to do no. Don't nobody want to do no Royal Rumbling anyway. And then on top of that, you know, it's now we have resort to flagging channels. We're gonna take your channel down. We don't want you. So are you? Can you replace me? You can't. You can't do it. You get what I'm saying? That's the thing that bothers me. It's not like I'm trying to replace you, right? You want me gone and I'm out the way. I'm 10 people deep in my chat. How am I in the way? Do you see what I'm saying? Oh, so that didn't get out the way. We see, the thing is, we got to get together and tell everybody how ugly she is. So therefore, people won't go to her chat room. People won't support because she ugly. So her voice don't match her face. So that'll get her out of there. That didn't work. They tried that the first year. It's the same ingredient of trying. Let's push her out. We're going to troll her. We're going to make her cam up. So we're going to keep talking about her looks, because eventually, like how we did, these same dummies got trolled into everybody knowing who the fuck they are. Your children are unprotected. Your peace is unprotected. Everything about you is unprotected. Because you wanted to keep it real. So you, these same people who have so much to say about me, got trolled into telling all their business. Everything. And so now I'm supposed to get trolled into it. And now, since that, 4 years have passed, right? In the beginning, I used to all the time. But now, I did an interview with, I interviewed Cynthia Ashe Divine. I was cammed up, okay? But they don't want to talk about that because they want you to believe these illusions. Who else? When I announced the interview, I did a video, posted it. But like I said, it's all supposed to be mental. Trolling is mental. You get what I'm saying? So they don't realize that they're the stupid, they're dumb. And so I say, believe whatever you want to believe about what you think about me. And once that didn't work, now that they result to flagging. So, oh, I love this. Oh my God. I listen to YouTube all the time when I'm in the shower. It's like the best. And I just read up on some stress relief from Bath and Body Work. China probably bought that. I don't know. China buys me stuff all the time. But I got some stress relief. Bath and Body Work is my favorite. They got buy three, get three free in Florida. So I don't know. It's like I was questioning about you being a Marine and the evidence on someone's channel for the longest. Hey, I don't know what they want from me. My boot camp picture is out. Then it was, I believe somebody said it was, you take pictures before like third. That was a Marine who said it. Graduation pictures is right before the Crucible. The Crucible is the last thing that you perform before actually becoming a Marine. So you go through physical, you go through gun qualification, and then you go through swim qual. And then after that, you get ready for graduation. And right before graduation, you take your pictures. If you don't make it through the Crucible, I don't know what happens. I never Googled what happens if you don't make it through the Crucible. You probably would have to do it over again. The Crucible is very hard. And so I don't, maybe I didn't pass the Crucible and I took my pictures. I have a huge USMC on my arm, and I love it, as a matter of fact. And then I got a big giant eagle on my arm as well. And I'm soon to get a eagle globe and anchor, okay? Probably on my foot, I'm not sure. You guys see Miss Mo? I don't see Miss Mo. Okay, guys. Well, hopefully, China, do you want to collab? I know you're into relationship talk and all of that stuff. This channel here, before my backup got fled, was supposed to be specifically for relationship talk and stuff like that. You like to talk sexual, sensual, and I like that too. And it's a whole vibe. And are you single? I don't know. I'm married. You're single. I think that would be a good collab. And also I like your view from the unicorn view that you do. I'm not going to lie. Like I've been checking out your videos just to see, what you speak about. And, it's kind of like mistressy. I like that because I feel as though women that are in relationships should know the mind of the mistress. Before I left, I did a show on the kept, how to be a kept. And I would really like to collab with you and have you talk about that. And I don't frown down at that at all. I think that, you know, married woman should hear what women that, you know, are kept or are unicorns, whatever they call them, or, you know, I think that life should be introduced. It's a form of sexuality. And I want to talk about it. Coco, did you download this? Because maybe you could do 3 and 4 tomorrow for me and could give me a break. Oh, she came in early. Wait. Oh, Miss Mo came in early. Okay, I'm so sorry. I was reading. And so I didn't catch all who came in. My apologies. Okay. You could, yeah, okay. So you do have it downloaded. All right. So 3 and 4. Can you do that tomorrow? And I'll just email. Fuck, I'll just do a time. Now I could just do it. Let me see something. Sorry, I'm using my touchscreen. Hold on. That's what's up. I could definitely give a time now. Fuck. Who is this? Yollywood news tip. Miss Rez confesses her failed love connection to Buddy Lee. However, at 1 hour, 27 minute mark, Coolin offer her coochie to Rez. What the fuck is going on? Child. Somebody, that's a troll. I can't tell y'all who it is. They just sent it today. I wasn't even trying to go in that email. What in the world? So would they try and go together? I ain't know Coolin was a bootlegger child. All right, so what I'm going into, okay. Let me see what I can do tomorrow, what I got on my calendar. Because I think I'm supposed to be working on my nursery. Garden, that is. All right, so yeah, you available around like All right, I would say about like, what you think about 10 o'clock? Sorry, child, I was looking at Diva, my baby daddy, to take his earbuds. Oh my God, hey, Mr. Keith. Child, Mr. Keith, y'all, he be keeping me in that shit, honey, and got a whole wife. Don't you, Mr. Keith? Tell him, Mr. Keith, be keeping me in that shit. 10 a.m. You want to do it that early? All right, bet. That'll be solid. Shit. I was going to prefer the morning, but I know your time is, I think, what you, 3 hours? 3 hours or 1 hour? You West Coast time? Whoops. Don't make me say Pacific. Pacific. As long as I ain't say specific. But 10 o'clock. Your time or time? Child, Mr. Keith, stay me. He, listen. I could do 10 a.m. That's 7 a.m. my time. You gonna be out? Let's do 11. That's what's up. The earlier the better for me. I love the morning. My time, I be like, child. You want to do 11? All right, bet. So, you going to be up, girl? That's, what, 8 o'clock? All right. Well, I'm going to set the live stream Yeah, all right. So that's two. You got two. I'm sorry, you got three and four, right? Okay, my phone, cool. I know, because you be out in the YouTube streets, child, late and early in the morning, child, I be asleep. I'm about to watch this. This thing on Netflix, what it's called. The Jazzman's Blues. A Jazzman's Blues. I'm about to watch that right now. That's number 7 in movies. Yes, I'm up. So, all right, so bet. All right, so 11 o'clock. You know me. So 11 o'clock, my time probably like 11:30. And you got chapter 3 and 4. All right, so I'll make sure I'll, you'll see the live stream up. You know how I am, child. Or either, you know, I see I got a lot of emails. So I'm going to be in there tomorrow morning. So I'm going to be able to hit you up anyway. I know. Make an IG. I'm going to make an IG. Listen, don't bother me. All right, you guys. I'll see you guys tomorrow. Well, you see Coco. She's going to do a show tomorrow. That's what's up. That'll give me a break. Coco, make sure you, if you guys want to cash app her and all of that, we can add that to the live stream. And as well, so I'll be donating too. I'm no different. All right. She donates to me. I can donate to her. All right. So we'll see you guys tomorrow, 11:30 Eastern Standard Time. And, well, just Eastern Standard Time, because that's what the fuck I'm at. All right. All right, guys. I'll see you guys tomorrow. Bye, Juicy. He want to talk about everybody in my chat room. Like, I don't understand. And then as soon as I take his wrench, he just cry all day long. Follow me in chat rooms and everything. Talking about, is he off of what we call the punishment? Okay, well, that's the spot. If she wants to be live, she could be live. Sometimes we be in there, sometimes we don't. He got to just tell everything in here. Didn't Mama Rose already cut you out about that already? Bye, y'all. I don't hear no outro. You know, I always wanted to play this one. Let me see something here. That's pretty groovy. I like that one. Anyway, see y'all.